In the port of Djibouti, dozens of boxes with MSF or Red Cross stickers, two of the rare international aid organizations still working in Yemen. They're sharing the same boat, as this is the only way to get to Aden, the largest city in the south that has been badly hit by the fighting.
The problem is that Aden Airport has been totally destroyed, so the only way in is by boat. We're lucky to be able to dock, but the port of Aden itself is quite dangerous. Last week, the day before we got there, a boat transporting refugees was sunk.
It's been 3 months since the fighting began. On one side are the Houthi rebels who have taken control of much of the country, and on the other, forces loyal to the president and the Saudi Arabia-led international coalition. A ceasefire agreement, signed at the end of May, officially lasted 5 days, but the hostilities never really stopped.
We heard the clashes, we heard bombing everywhere, so I don't believe in ceasefire. There is no truce. There is no ceasefires at all.
An MSF team treats the wounded in this hospital in Aden. Every day sees more casualties caused by the fighting that is often very close by.
This patient is a victim of an abdominal gunshot wound. He had severe vascular injuries. He had a gunshot wound through the aorta, and he had severe blood loss and profound shock even before we started resuscitation. Even if we continued for more than an hour with maximum resuscitation, he didn't manage to survive during surgery.
The hospital is working at full capacity, but to reach out to the many people still without access to healthcare, MSF opened a clinic in Crater District.
The people cannot transfer to other area because the way is blocked, and many patients suffer here from injury, gunshot and charbonnel, and receive management here, cannot take access away to other hospital.
A few days later, an MSF team went to another neighborhood in Aden, where residents from Crater have taken refuge.
Gunshot where? Left leg. A man is a displaced place for the people that was in Prater Mualla. Then we decide to come in this place to do 2 times in a week the dressing for patients that need follow-up, but it can reach our hospital. Particularly we are for injuring patient during this war.
Sana, Taz, Hamir. Fighting continues across the country, resulting in both direct and indirect victims. Countless people are displaced and bearing the consequences of shortages caused by difficulties in getting supplies through. In the north and center of Iraq, it's the civilians who bear the brunt of the conflict. The humanitarian crisis is now chronic, and many displaced families have no access to sanitation or drinking water. In this village near Kirkuk, around 100 families have fled from advancing Islamic State forces.
I don't think we'll ever go home. The situation is bad, and day after day, it will get worse.
Like Yassin and his family, 3 million people have fled the fierce fighting in several regions of Iraq. Except in the most secure areas, they have almost no access to aid, as humanitarian organizations are few and far between. These women carry everything they own on their heads. As they arrive in this displaced person's camp in Bentiu in the north of the country, they speak of burnt-out villages, killings, looting and rape. The camp is under United Nations protection, but even then, it is no safe haven for the thousands of refugees as the fighting continues right outside.
The violence-related cases we received were mainly those who got the injuries while they were in the village. They were caught by a shell and also stray bullet. The second kind of injuries, these are patients we are receiving from the protection of civilians that are here in the United States, here in Bentiu. They got injuries from stray bullet where even they are still in the tukurs within the protection of civilians.
Compared to previous months, the number of new patients arriving at MSF's hospital in Bentiu tripled in April, and the onset of the rainy season in these overcrowded camps will further worsen an already dire humanitarian emergency. Antibiotic resistance affects all countries in the world, but without a reliable, comprehensive system to collect data, it's impossible to get a real global overview of the situation. So let's focus on one particular region, the Middle East. In its hospital in Amman in Jordan, MSF treats casualties from Iraq and Syria and has observed that around 50% of its patients suffer from a multi-drug resistant germ infection. Why? The context first. Population displacements caused by conflict foster the propagation of bacteria. Moreover, the destruction of hospitals and poor hygiene result in the wounded being treated in unsanitary environments. But it also stems from a more global phenomenon: antibiotics being overprescribed by doctors, being available off the shelf in stores, and being misused by patients. How does antibiotic resistance come about? Bacteria become resistant either from a random genetic mutation or because they get wise to an antibiotic with repeated exposure and thereby learn to fend it off. To understand how resistance spreads, let's take a closer look at this bacteria sample, which is similar to what can be found in our bodies. Some bacteria are good, but others make us ill, and some of these may already be resistant. When an antibiotic is introduced, most of the bacteria disappear, including the good bacteria, which are there to help our bodies defend themselves. So only the resistant ones remain, and they are free to multiply. Worse still, they can transmit the information to other bacteria, showing them how to become resistant. This can lead to severe health problems that can be extremely difficult, if not impossible, to treat. What can be done? There are no new antibiotics on the horizon. And anyway, waiting for new drugs to come out onto the market isn't an option, as the whole process will simply happen all over again. Preventing resistance calls for attacking the root causes. Firstly, the behavioral causes, making people aware of the need to use antibiotics with moderation, and better informing health workers to avoid inappropriate or over-prescription. But we must go even further and address the health system itself. Regulating the sale of antibiotics and setting up solid surveillance networks are essential. If we don't, we may as well just forget many of today's antibiotics.
This is the map of Nigeria. Here is the capital, Since 2009, there is a fighting between the Nigerian army and a group called Boko Haram. Around 1.5 million people displaced from their villages and towns in Borno State and the neighboring states. More than 14,000 people were killed. Unfortunately, the crisis that big didn't have any strong presence in the international agenda. And I think the human cost of this crisis was so huge that it should draw the attention of everyone in the world. Unfortunately, the behavior of the media, of the international media with the Nigerian problem was very selective. It was mentioned only the Chibok girls, around 200 more than 200 girls were kidnapped from a school. It shouldn't be a surprise if you know that that was not the first time this number of girls kidnapped in the northeast of Nigeria, and it won't be the last as well. So the killing was indiscriminate, the kidnapping was indiscriminate, and it happened all the time there. Unfortunately, it was highlighted only once or twice, not more than that. And I think the international community should realize that there is a huge crisis on the make and ongoing now in the country, and the response should be even better. We need more engagement of the international community in this crisis. Otherwise, the human cost will be huge, more than what we are seeing now, and it will not stop anytime soon.